Hi everyone, good afternoon, and welcome again in our Friday afternoon habit, hashtag Chakrachat. We are very, very pleased that we are already in our season two of our program, and we cannot thank you enough for being here and for sharing your time and your thoughts with us. As we are already in our season two of learning together and deepening our practice, we are very fortunate to reach this far. You know, your Chakra Chat session started as your yoga teachers in Chakra. We're just checking in with each other and as our way of coping and sort of kamustahan session. And then it really started informally, and eventually we have been doing quite well with our conversations that we have had in the past few weeks. Like in our practice of yoga, we felt the inner desire to share the fruits of our conversations that hopefully can complement your asana practice with the goal of giving everyone a full life. We have had amazing guests in the past weeks, and I'm sure it actually created a lot of realizations and reflections on how we can prosper in our yoga practice, in our life in general. No, if you would remember, we have had financial literacy. We invited a doctor to talk about the effects of yoga in our brain and in our system. We also talked about kids yoga, and we talked about a lot of different varied information that, again, hopefully can complement our yoga practice as a whole. And speaking of having a full life, our Chakra Chat episodes help us to understand that our yoga is not just about our relationship in going to our mats, no, or performing asanas or poses, but more importantly, yoga is about bringing more life to ourselves. And as we bring more life within us, then we can share this life to our community. In our episode last week, we talked about the importance of influence and how we are capable of influencing others. No? And we invited last week a public figure. We invited Ms. Nicole Abbas Batayan. We reinforced the idea that those who can make a difference in the community is not just those who we know have power or who are considered public figures. No? But also those who have a sense of mission and advocacy. Interestingly enough, we also talk about how social media would have a very strong influence, especially during these times. No? You know, the generation now sees social media as a very powerful tool to engage, to promote, or even to share content. And our guests for today will surely help us in deepening our ideas of creating contents positively in social media. And this episode is entitled Mindful Vlogging. Our guest this afternoon is a yoga teacher since 2012. She's the owner of Asana Yoga Plus Movement in Cebu City. She's a vlogger and content creator, or shall we say yogipreneur, or a yogi and entrepreneur. She is currently based in BGC Taguig City, and we are so happy to have her here in our show for today. Let us welcome our guest, Ms. Rica Hernandez.
Hi, Rica. Good afternoon. Good afternoon, Teacher Sam. It's so great to be here.
Yes, and it's so great to have you here in our episode, Teacher Rica. How are you so far, Teacher Rica? How have you been coping with our situation in the past few months?
Well, just like everybody, I have been feeling the same, you know, heaviness as everybody else, but you just gotta put your yoga practice to the test and take things one breath at a time, day by day. And yeah, so that's how I'm thriving, not just surviving in this time.
Yeah. And in the introduction that I have read, no, Teacher Rica, I'm interested to know, how have you been balancing your time since you own a studio in Cebu, but you're currently based in Manila? How do you manage these two things?
Well, currently the studio is no longer operational because you know naman what's happening, diba? But I keep in touch with my co-owner. I keep in touch with some of my students. And it's always an ongoing thing whether you have a studio or not, diba? Like the community still lives on. And I think that's really the, you know, the studio lives on through the people. That's what I believe. So I balance my time because I work hard. I wake up every day at 2:45 a.m. because I have multiple jobs. And I am not currently teaching yoga at the moment because I feel like I need to reserve the yoga part for myself, especially at this time. And so I balance my day and manage my time by, instead of thinking of time management, I've shifted to thinking of energy management and really being mindful of where I put my attention to. And it's so easy to be influenced in a bad way because social media is so loud, it's so noisy. But I live also on social media because I'm a content creator, and that's why I love the idea of mindful content creating. Because just like being a yoga teacher, when you create sequences for your students, you gotta be mindful in creating sequences and classes for your students.
Teacher Rica, I'm very interested with what you said, that more than time management, it's really about energy management. And it's a very refreshing take on how we use and focus our energy. Could you kindly expound on the idea of energy management and how you try to live by concretely this idea of energy management?
Okay, well, because, you know, I love being busy and I love productive. What happened to me a lot of times since 2012 is that I would hit burnout moments like all the time. And they say when you reach burnout more than twice a year, parang that's a little bit too much, but I would reach burnout a lot. So I said, what's going on? Like, I have this passion and drive to do stuff. I really enjoy creating and doing things, whether it's you know, working or making videos or whatever. So I was like, there's gotta be a way to do all of this because I see people doing a lot and they still have like a smile on their faces, and, you know. So I started really studying nutrition and studying psychology, trying to figure out like, okay, where are the leaks of, you know, where are the leaks of my energy? Like, I needed to be aware and spot, like, okay, I'm practicing too hard. I'm doing too much physical asana, you know, or I'm working too much mentally on projects that it's not returning to me that the way it should, because everything is balanced. Right? So I said, you know what, instead of me giving up one area of my work, right? They say like, oh, the dream is to quit the 9-to-5 job. I have a 3 a.m. to 10 to 9 a.m. job. So that's my 9-to-5. It's 3 a.m. to 9 a.m. I was like, I don't want to give up that income just so I can be happier. Why don't I train my body to handle the stress, train my mindset, and manage my energy so that I can do and maximize my day? So what are the things that I can eliminate so that I can put intentional energy on what matters, which is my job matters, my work matters, my yoga practice matters, but it doesn't matter anymore to me that I go so full on hardcore asana practice. Like before, I was just super arm balanced to death, you know. Right now my practice is very chill, just a few inversions, and I'm already happy and at peace with that. So it's like being okay with where you deposit your energy throughout the day. And it takes a lot of practice to get used to that.
Yeah, I agree. There was even just a personal sharing. There was a time that I too was really going hardcore asanas, no? And then eventually you really appreciate some moments of your time practicing restorative or yin yoga just to relax and to regain back the energy. So thank you for that, Teacher Rica. I'm interested, Teacher Rica, no, how did your yoga journey started? No, in the introduction, you became a teacher 2012, but I'm sure that before becoming a teacher, your yoga journey started already. Maybe you might want to share how your yoga journey started.
Well, I remember the moment my yoga journey started, and it wasn't even yoga specifically. It was the moment I decided to change my life through exercise. So wala pa yung yoga noon, but the program that I chose had a yoga day once a week. And I really hated it. I thought yoga was so slow and boring and dumb. But when I tried the program, and I'm the type of person that when I commit, I really go all in. You know, I was big and a little bit fluffy. I was like, I have to do the yoga day. On my first day of yoga, it was a 90-minute power yoga session. I got fever after, and I really hated it because it was the hardest thing I ever did. And so that sparked intrigue. I was like, how come so many millions of people swear by this yoga thing? They look so happy and strong and whatever. I'm like, I hate them all. I hate all of them. Like, what's their secret? So I kept going. And after 2 months of doing it once a week, that was the moment I felt the breathing and just being truly in the moment. And then I did the Shavasana for the first time, and it was like, oh my God, this is why. And that was such a profound moment. So from then on, I started doing it twice a week, thrice a week, mamaya every day na, and I couldn't keep it to myself anymore. I was like, I need to share this. This is so cool. And then I became a teacher. So yeah.
And how has yoga helped you in general?
Well, in general, because my life has kind of been like an emotional roller coaster in terms of relationships, yoga was there to show me that I'm made of a lot, made of steel, you know? Like, that's why I went really hardcore on the postures. Like, I had to do the hardest ones, and I had to prove to myself that I can do the arm balances and the transitions and stuff like that, because that was that practice was going to reflect back to me every day. And I started taking pictures of myself and seeing, like, wow, that I can't believe that's me. Like, I could do that. And then I started to post it, and people were like, wow, you can do that, you? And I'm like, I like this feeling that I feel like I'm celebrating myself, not just other people are saying wow also. And that's where I learned how to appreciate my self-value and self-worth through yoga, which helped me be stronger in, you know, my relationship and stuff.
Okay. Two days back, I was watching the video that Teacher XP has posted, that you were vlogging about how to nurture a home practice, though. In yoga, and I really like the video actually. I would like to ask, when did you start vlogging, and what drew you from starting your own YouTube channel, for example?
So after I became a yoga teacher, I put up a studio with my partner, who is my best friend. And at the start of it palang, I knew where I wanted to hopefully take the company. I wanted to offer online classes, which it, you know, it never happened. But at the start palang, I was like, I want my studio to be modern. I want it to be online, you know, that kind of thing. And people in Cebu, some people frowned upon it because they were like, oh, you shouldn't do that. It takes out the yoga. And for me, I was like, no, I know what I believe in, and I think this is a good thing. Anyway, you know, time went by. I didn't have the energy to do it, although I tried. I left Cebu na, and I put up the YouTube channel in hopes of teaching my students in Cebu some of my yoga stuff. And when I was filming my yoga classes for the YouTube channel, it never really made it on my channel because I started to explore vlogging in general. Like, how would I vlog a boring day? What would that look like? And then I started to like the creative process of editing and things like that. So nawala yung yoga channel, but that's how it started.
I see. Teach, what do you think are the rewards of vlogging? Of course, there are tangible and perhaps intangible things that you got from vlogging, no? And what has been your biggest reward as a vlogger?
Well, my biggest reward as a vlogger or content creator is that you really start to ask questions that you wouldn't normally ask yourself on a daily basis. Like, what do you really want to show people today? And how are you showing that thing through your videos? Like, do you think your viewers are going to sit there and watch and get bored? How are you going to relay the message? Does it sound like it's all about you? Or do you actually have something to exchange to your viewer? Like, so those were the questions that popped into my head, you know, when I would create content, whatever it was. And I got into so many random content stuff. Like, I got into makeup, I got into concerts and whatever. And I was always asking myself, like, is this what I want to teach people or show people about me? Like, because we're so multifaceted that I feel like getting stuck with one part of yourself is hard. I couldn't stick to just yoga on my YouTube channel because it was a platform for me to explore, you know? So parang that was a benefit I had in vlogging. It was kind of like journaling, but three-dimensional, because you have to see, you have to listen, you have to create the story. And that the tangible stuff was I made a lot of friends. You know, the community of content creators, they have such a passion and drive for making videos also that it's nice to be around creators, like real creators that are trying to be authentic. And you can see the struggle that sometimes nagiging fake and they don't want to be fake, you know. So it ties in with authenticity, which is also the teaching of yoga, diba? So I like how it all ties in together.
Yeah, and I am just wondering, no, Teacher Rica, how much time do you spend in creating your content or your videos, for example? Like, for a person like me, I'm not really a video editor. No? I'm interested to know, how much time do you spend in, like, deciding what to share and then filming and then editing it? How much time do you spend so that you'd be able to provide a video in your channel, for example?
A lot of hours, a lot. Like, sometimes 4 days. And that's the reason why I slowed down specifically on vlogging and YouTubing, because it just takes way too much time and energy to produce like kind of quality that like I would want to watch. So I shifted to creating 1 minute videos that are intentionally just to motivate people, and I moved that to TikTok, and that content it blew up. Like, I gained so much followers in just 6-7 weeks. Like, I'm on my 7th week and there's already almost 70,000 people. So, you know, I realized that you don't always have to invest so much time to create something that will resonate with people. You just have to be very precise, concise. You just got to be clear on what message you wanna tell. And that happened all through the process of going through the 16-hour edits for a stupid vlog about me, I don't know, in the beach doing whatever. It's like, what value am I giving people there? But the video's nice. So, yun.
I like the idea how the importance of creating value, you know, not just putting out several contents out there. But I'm also interested to know, though, don't you run out of contents to share? You know, you've been doing this in a regular basis. Don't you run out of things to share to your audience?
The truth is, Never. My philosophy is this this idea of never running out of things to talk about and say, even if it's about one topic, came from me being a yoga studio owner and teacher, because at the start of my yoga studio, kulang ng teachers, di ba? So I have to teach most of the classes. And it was training grounds for me to come. So it's not like Ashtanga where you teach the same thing over and over. So I learned how to be creative in my planning, and then faster in the way I produce different sequences, because some of my students would attend every single day. So parang corny naman if they, and that's what they like. They like that my classes were always different. And I was like, how many times can you do a warrior two and make it interesting for the students? And so that's what forced me to think that, okay, you know what? The more you put out things, the more ideas will come in. And that's how I feel about putting out content. Like, I never run out.
Yeah. We have here, Teacher Rica, a question from one of our guests before in Chakrachat, and also he also has a podcast with his cousin. He is asking, what are the other areas of the yoga market here in the Philippines that Filipinos can still explore other than having a yoga studio?
What are the areas of the yoga market here in the PI that Pinoys can still explore? You mean like in terms of practicing?
Yeah, perhaps in terms of practicing, or like what you mentioned earlier, that not just taking the yoga classes in a yoga studio, but doing YouTubing, blogging. What other areas can we explore for the yoga market here in the country?
Well, I'm not sure if my answer will be controversial or not, but I think really, and I really support everybody doing online yoga. I really support the apps, because there were many days that I would use apps, you know. But I think the best thing to explore when it comes to yoga is coming up with a self-practice that is truly your own. You figure out your unique way of doing yoga, you know. That's what I believe in, because I was taught that way early on when I started. It was always like self-practice, you know, really going in. And I would never have discovered what I love, and never would have discovered how much capacity I have for doing all of these crazy poses if I just kept joining other classes that is tailored and customized for the general public. Because my mentality was, I needed a very hardcore practice. And for the sake of safety, a general class will not push that far. So I needed to look for that, and I discovered that alone. So, you know, I encourage people to discover what they want. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you very much for that answer, Teacher Rica, and also for the question, Ben. And thank you for watching our episode for today. Now, the episode for today is entitled Mindful Blogging. In your own opinion, no, what does mindful blogging mean for you, Teacher Rica?
So mindful blogging for me is the process of not just living in the moment when you take your camera out, but it's kind of like journaling, where you translate whatever your thoughts are and your ideas onto paper. You try to bring your thoughts to life through the camera. You try to let people see what you see in your mind. And so you gotta be very mindful, because it never comes out the way you think it is. you know, it always comes out a different look or a different story. And so being mindful of how you can translate what's up here takes a lot of energy, because, you know, when we talk to ourselves, you know, the dialogue we have of ourselves, it reflects on in our actions, diba? Like if we have negative self-talk or positive self-talk, you can see it in the person's face, you can see it in the person's action. So same, what the kind of story, the kind of content you have in your head, if you can translate it out into a video, I feel like you are strengthening your communication skills. So, yeah.
And in relation to that, Teacher Rica, I have a question from Teacher XP, who is also watching us right now. Tell us, Teacher Rica, how do we train ourselves to be mindful in vlogging? Do you have any tips on how to be mindful in terms of vlogging exercises and activities?
Well, to be mindful in vlogging, first of all, you have to get over listening to yourself, and that takes practice. You have to face the camera, you have to look at the lens, and you have to watch yourself, watch the way you move, watch your eyebrows, see if you're looking around, and then study public speaking. You know, make your voice loud. You're not just vlogging and saying, this is my water today. Like, you tell people, like, hey guys, I'm drinking this today and blah blah blah. You know, it's like you're very intentional. Keep the camera still and develop your confidence in using your voice, because the most annoying thing about people vlogging or just in video in general is you can't be heard. If I can't hear the person, tapos maganda yung visual, click out talaga yon. Nobody will watch. So it's more on, number one is your voice and what you're saying, and the aesthetics is secondary.
Okay, there you have it, Teacher Exi. Thank you for the question. And he also has a follow-up question, Teacher Rica, no? He asked, what are some examples of mindfulness exercises that you can share to our viewers that you, for example, personally do in the day-to-day encounter that you have?
Mindfulness exercise. Oh gosh, there's so many. Well, I think one of my favorite mindfulness exercises is listening to motivational talks, listening to mga TED talk, mga ganyan, or any kind of presentation besides educational, and then writing down just a few key highlights that resonate with you. I've been doing that every single day for so long, and it's so helpful because it parang reinforces the learning. You hear it, you learn it, but when you write it, you learn it again, and then when you recite it and you speak it, you learn it again. That's why teachers are so powerful, because they get to learn things over and over again because they get to teach it over and over again. So I think writing and listening and writing, taking down notes, is definitely a must mindfulness exercise.
Yeah, I think that also, like, keeping a journal and writing regularly can help you see your progress and what happened before, what are the things that you write, and how are you progressing in terms of how you see things. You know? So I think that journaling is really a very good mindfulness exercise that our viewers can do at home.
And not just journaling, like, what you feel, but it really helps to explore, like, more vocabulary words. Like, you know, in high school and in grade school, I really hated vocabulary, but now I appreciate it because different words open up a whole new universe. You're able to describe one thing a million ways, so you become more articulate and more expressive in the way you describe how you feel, and then it becomes more clear. So when you read your journals back, it's like, wow, I can actually relive the moment just by reading what is on my paper.
Right. And earlier, Teacher Rica, you have made mention that if you want to be a mindful blogger, you need to really develop your competencies in speaking, in holding the camera, perhaps. And I think that this is quite similar to our yoga practice, right? When yeah. we try to develop our arms, for example, so that we can do the other poses more effectively, you know. I'm interested to know, how does your blogging complement your yoga practice?
Well, my blogging complements my yoga practice because primarily I wanted to continue filming myself doing yoga, but I wanted it to be a little bit more creative. And how are you going to be creative filming yourself doing yoga, right? So, it's attention to detail, kind of like what a asana practice is. You got to feel your fingers. You got to feel the backs of your knees and your neck and your earlobes. You feel all of that when you're practicing. So when you're creating videos, you start to see angles that you never would have thought before because you're so aware. You're so secure and aware within your body that now, like, this room, my room is so tiny. I know I can make an interesting, like, 1 minute little vlog just in my room. So I think that's how yoga and vlogging kind of like mesh together. It's seeing the details.
Right. Teach, there's so much negativity, you know, in social media. I mean, people have been ranting, sharing all these negative emotions, placing and even directing their anger, their angst, you know, to other people in social media. How do you, as a mindful individual, help in alleviating these negativities that we can see in social media?
How did I help alleviate that yes. for some people?
Yes. Now, how can you try to make it a little bit more positive, perhaps, considering that you seem to be a person who's very into social media?
Well, it all goes back to mindful vlogging or mindful content creation, because it's so easy to read and react and comment onto the bad stuff. So first of all, you gotta not be part of the news. The moment I see mga news, like, whatever, I don't even bother. You can't engage in it, because when you engage in it, it that negative energy just grows, diba? So what are you gonna do? You can not react and not do anything, or you can try to counteract it by contributing to Facebook and sharing something positive. Like, that's one point for the positive theme. And not enough people are doing it, because it's so easy to be gossipy and chismis with the masarap kasi to be part of the people that parang, oh, we hate the government, we hate this, we hate that. Like, yeah, me too, I hate that. But okay, let's focus on something that can expand and make us feel good, because it doesn't help. It doesn't help to feel like crap. So do your part. And if you need to say something positive, like, don't be lazy and just be like, ah, okay lang yan. Like, take action talaga. Like, be a warrior for the good, in other words.
Yeah, yeah. And I think, diba, it's something related to what you have earlier mentioned about energy management. So if you don't want those negative contents to really affect you, then just veer away and take action. You know, I think that's a new idea that you have made mention now, that you just don't passively accept by disregarding this, but to take action and contribute otherwise, you know, what you want to see in social media. Now, each, you know, that kids and young people in general have been so drawn, you know, in becoming a YouTuber or a blogger. I think they too, like you, wanted to be heard or to be listened to. what would you advise to these young kids and even those who are interested to be YouTubers or content creators or bloggers? Because you know, I work in a school, and when we did a survey of what they wanted to be in the future, hindi na mga doktor, hindi na engineer. They already wanted to be YouTubers and content creators, no? So what are your advice to these kids and to anyone who wanted to create content in YouTube or in social media?
Well, I could answer that because my two kids, I have two teenagers. They're 14 and 16 years old. And when they were very little, they wanted to be YouTubers. And part of actually why I put up a YouTube channel is because I wanted to know the process so that I can help them put their channels up. But anyway, my advice for those kids is, it would actually be for the parents, no? Na encourage your kids to explore creating content, but emphasize more that, like, the vanity metrics, which is the followers, the likes. You really have to be firm and say that don't focus on that, because that's just going to ruin everything. You're going to create content just for the likes and the views and the, you know, the analytics. And it's such a horrible reason to make content, because you start to do things, you start to do stupid things just for the views. And there's a lot of young kids that do that, especially like on TikTok, because I'm on TikTok now and I never watch TikTok, but it's like, oh wow, like nobody tells these kids that, okay, it's okay to have fun and everything, but sometimes what you're doing is borderline really stupidity, you know? And there are people that die because they're so gutsy and ballsy about creating dangerous, you know, shocking content. And it all stems from the insecurity and wanting to be liked. So my kids, like, I keep encouraging them, if you want to continue, go, but it's not about the likes, it's not about that. You create the good content and the followers will follow. It's just the law of the universe, right? Yeah. You give value, they'll follow you. Yeah.
Thank you, Teach. Those are valuable insights, no? And reminder for our kids that work not for the likes or the things that you can get from it, but what the valuable things that you can share, not through the content that you will be creating. Teach, let's go now to your being a yogipreneur. No, we have here a question again from Ben. What is your outlook of the yoga studio considering our COVID times? No, especially there are a lot of those who were able to easily adapt, no, with the situation. They did online classes, but there are also some yoga studios having a hard time, no, trying to manage their business of handling the studio, considering that the pandemic has badly affected them. So what is your outlook now of a yoga studio considering our current situation?
Well, in terms of business, I think, because I'm part of the International Yoga Studio Owners on Facebook, diba? So it's disheartening seeing all these beautiful 10 years, 15 years, 20 year old studios finally saying goodbye, things like that. And to those that are still operating, it's like, we all know that the business of yoga isn't, you don't get so much money from it. Like, being a yoga studio owner, like the math part, the money part, it's not glamorous. It's, you know, but you do it out of service and you try to keep it open because you care about your students and the community. But it's hard as a coming there from being there myself. It's like your heart is there to help provide a sanctuary, but in business, money doesn't care. It's like, if you can't pay your rent, you gotta watch out for your well-being, because you as a yoga person and a yoga business owner, if you stress out way too much and you can't deliver, you can't pay your rent, you will also suffer as a teacher. And if you shift online, you will be teaching from a place of defeat. So you might as well cut your losses and stay, you know, walk away with what you have and try to rebuild or pivot, go online or do one-on-ones, something. But we can't be attached to the studio because, you know, nothing lasts forever, you know. Yeah. It's hard. I cried when my studio closed.
Diba? And considering these times, no, parang, you know, the studio is not really a physical structure kasi, diba, for us, no, who have been regularly practicing. The studio is more than a physical structure, but it's actually a community that we value. And the memories that we, you know, when we did our first headstand, no? So parang, it's really heartbreaking, no, to see some of the difficulties that our yoga studios are experiencing right now. But I think that some of the yoga studios are actually considering this not just a challenge but also an opportunity to grow, no, and to have a wider reach, diba? Kasi since with a lot of our yoga studios are being present online, no, so we have been able to share, no, our practice to a wider range of people, like this one, you know, before, parang after a yoga class we just go and then go separate ways and then without really deepening our practice through conversations like this, no, so yeah. I think that's an opportunity as well. When you mentioned that your yoga studio closed at each, no?
Yes.
How were you able to manage that, no? Because I'm sure that there are some yoga studios that are closing out at this particular point. No? What advice perhaps you can share to them having gone through the same situation as some of the yoga studios are experiencing right now?
And are they like about to close also?
there are some.
Well, I think my advice would be coming from, like, you know, Marie Kondo, right? Have you read her book?
Yeah.
So, you know, it's like a yoga studio is like a gift. It's like a piece of clothing that your friend gave you. And sometimes it just doesn't fit anymore, or wala na, it has to go, it has to leave. You know, you can't keep it anymore. So what do? Marie Kondo said, you look at it and you say, thank you, namaste, thank you for, you've served your purpose and it's time for you to go. Yung mga gifts na may mga tag pa, yung mga clothes na ganun, kahit hindi mo siya ginamit, the purpose of that gift was to be a gift to you. And in that moment that you received it, it already fulfilled its purpose. So I think it helps to think of letting go of your studio that way, na parang it served and it will still serve in another form. So namaste and thank you. And I will just keep the memories of it in my heart. Ganyan.
Yeah. And I think that certain aspects of your life don't spark joy anymore, no, maybe it's about time to let go of these things, no, or things that do not already serve us in positive ways that could develop us even more. And I think that's really part of yoga, diba? With a sense of detachment, no? And I think that if you don't detach kasi with whatever that doesn't serve you anymore, then it will inhibit you to grow, no? And I'm sure that after letting go that yoga studio and allowing it to serve its purpose, you've been a very good content creator now, and diba, parang you have served in another realm of being a yoga teacher perhaps also. So yeah. Thank you very much. Teacher Rica, no, I'm really inspired. I specifically I'm struck with the first thing you mentioned about energy management more than time management. It's really very striking for me, and
way, no, of thinking. Because a lot of people think that, oh, okay, I'm so good at planning my schedule, and they plan and whatever, but if you don't have the energy to do it anyway, what's the point? You're gonna produce like low quality work, low quality everything, and then maiinis ka lang. So, yun.
Yeah, and I'm sure that since a lot of our students right now are working the home based online classes, though, and I remember being a student, and you know we spend a lot of time, you know, long hours in the evening just to study and forcing ourselves, you know, to digest things given by our professors. And di ba sayang time? It could have been made use for rest, but then eventually use your time after rest para mas na-absorb mo yung mga pinag-aaralan mo, di ba? So I think it's a very good concept, energy management. It's something that really is that struck me right now. And in fact, Teacher XT is commenting that through that, you know, energy management love. So yeah, and we have here some other comments from Raymond Enriquez, Teacher Rica, so creepy. And then we have here Teacher XT mentioned hashtag one breath at a time. So yeah. thank you very much. Teacher Rica, anything you would want to invite our viewers where they can catch you, your YouTube channel perhaps?
Well, you guys can catch me on YouTube. It's Rica Hernandez, but right now I'm active on TikTok where I do motivation and I answer questions for, you know, the more on the millennial group. I think they need a lot of motivation. So catch me on TikTok, it's Rica_Hernandez. It's the same for Instagram, where, and that's where you kind of like get to know me as a person because I'm very active on stories. That's where I end up vlogging the most because, you know, stories, you're in the moment and then tomorrow, wala na, it expires. So it's a good practice for if you want to start vlogging, stories. IG stories is a great, easy platform to use.
Teacher Rica, by the way, I must say, no, your background in your bedroom is very nice, with all the lights, ganda. Did you decorate it your own?
Yeah, I bought those lights from Shopee, and yun nga, eh, that's the thing when you are mindfully vlogging, you see like, oh, my background, yung iba kasi may labahan sa likod, ganyan, so they're not mindful of it.
Like we always do in our yoga classes, we place our palms together and we bow down to each other saying namaste. Thank you very much, Teacher Rica.
Namaste. Thank you, Teacher Sam. Thanks for having me, guys.
So that has been a very nice conversation again with Teacher Rica here in Chakrachat. Thank you very much for those who joined us. And for those who wanted to rewatch and replay this conversation, you may do so in our official Facebook page in Chakrachat Yoga Studio. Magandang salamat sa tanan, and thank you for joining us.
Alam.